We'll move on to the third paper, which is Early Warnings of Currency Crisis in India. Thank you.
Good morning, all. I'm going to talk about identifying the early warnings of currency crisis in India. Basically, financial crises have induced huge debate on theoretical and empirical debate in recent times, given their recurrent nature in the history of economics. I quote Kindleberger here, like, academics are interested in economic crisis as they have had a history of fascination for the crisis. Policymakers are interested because they want to prevent the crisis, and financial market participants are interested because they want to make money out of it. Financial crisis can be divided into two broad categories. One is currency crisis or sudden stops. Other is debt or banking crisis. Here we focus on currency crisis as they have swept away Argentina, Brazil, Latin America, Russia, Southeast Asia, and United Kingdom, and they also affected India in the past. So currency crisis can be defined as a situation where country's exchange rate depreciates rapidly, or depletion of reserves in a short period of time, or it can be a combination of both. There are three generations of models to explain the case of currency crisis. The first generation models were developed after the first wave of Latin American currency crisis. And the second generation models were developed after the breakdown of European exchange rate mechanism And the third generation models were developed after the 1997 East Asian currency crisis. In this context, like, we looked into this India's case, and previous literature and the macroeconomic structure suggests that there is that these three generations of models do not explain the case of currency crisis in India. And there are no studies there is only one study on India's case. And in this context, like, we focus on India's vulnerability to currency crisis. And we reviewed a selective empirical works in this context. And our main objective of this study is to study the likelihood of currency crisis in India. And other objective is to develop the early warning system and the find the determinants of the currency crisis. Rationale of the study is that, like, there haven't been any studies on India's vulnerability to currency crisis, and three generations of models and the subsequent literature are largely absent in the case. And in this context, we have taken data of 30 years from 1986 to 2015. It's a monthly data. We have taken four sectors: financial sector, external sector, and real sector, and fiscal sector. We have taken primarily two methodologies. One is KLR methodology, Kaminsky, Lizondo, Reinhardt, and the other is Lozit as an alternative. To build an early warning system, there are primarily four stages. Like, first we identify the currency crisis months, and then we select the variables based on the nature of the macroeconomic structure, and we extract signals from the variables, and then calculate the probabilities that are the likelihood of a currency crisis. Then we have adopted Lozit model as an alternative. First, coming to the currency crisis identification, we have developed exchange market pressure index, which is nothing but a percentage change in exchange rate minus ratio of the standard deviation of exchange rate and reserves multiplied by the percentage of change in reserves. So to extract the signals, we take this 2x2 matrix when there is a crisis. We have taken 12 months crisis origin. Whenever there is a a particular variable signals a crisis in this 12 month crisis origin, we put it in box A, and as I've shown, it all these signals fit into those four boxes, and based on that, like, we have calculated conditional, unconditional probabilities, type 1, type 2 errors, and mainly a noise to signal ratio. This is nothing but a ratio of bad signals to good signals. And based on that, we calculate the composite crisis indicator, whenever there is a signal from a particular variable and we divide it by its noise to signal ratio, and based on that we calculate the probabilities of crisis. And then we move on to logit model. This like we assign one if there is a crisis, otherwise zero. Coming to the results, like whenever the exchange market pressure index crosses the threshold percentile, we consider as a crisis. Otherwise, all the periods may not turn out to be full blown crisis. Like some of them could be stress periods. And like in this context, fiscal or monetary authorities may get into the picture and try to prevent it. And in this context, we have identified 22 such periods. Like only the early periods were followed by devaluation, rupee devaluation. And this from this, like based on the whether the variable is assumed to increase in the variable is assumed to cause crisis or decrease is assumed to cause crisis, we take the percentile. If in case of increase, we take the upper tile of the percentile, and decrease, we take the lower tile of the bottom tile of the percentile. When the noise to signal ratio is minimized, we consider as the percentile, threshold percentile. So we could see here, type 1 error is quite prevalent, and we have also calculated average lead time, like because we don't know which whether that particular variable is signal is giving warnings just before the crisis period or in advance, in 12 month crisis horizon. So here also we could see that it's all these variables just give just before the crisis. So that means there is no single variable that gives signals consistently throughout the periods. So yeah. Coming to the 1991 crisis, we have variables such as fiscal deficit, real exchange rate, reserves, M3 reserves issued warnings during this crisis months. Like it has started from 1998 and fully unfolded in 1991. And again, there was a stress period in 1993 due to change in exchange rate regime. And in that, in stock index, output, real exchange rate have issued signals. Again, there was a stress period in 1995. In this context, stock index and bank credit issued signals during this period. And again, in 1997, due to a Southeast Asian currency crisis, it had an impact on India too. Exports declined, and M3 multiplier and real exchange rate have increased. And after 1998 nuclear test, in the subsequent month, there was a stress in the currency due to which there was a decrease in exports stock index and an increase in the M3 multiplier. Again, in 2008, economy has witnessed a short period of currency crisis in which indicators sent just during this crisis period. Indicators such as banking credit, excess M1 balances, gold prices, oil prices, etc. have issued signals during this period. And India's monetary policy responded to this crisis by shifting its policy stance by monetary tightening, whereas government has implemented stimulus packages. In 2013, variables such as current account balance, deposits issued signals consistently throughout this period. This has started in 2011 and resulted in a full in 2013. However, it did not turn out to be a crisis like 1991, though there were some comparisons. To some extent, central bank's intervention in foreign exchange market also helped in preventing this depreciation further. Yeah, coming to the logit model, we have estimated five separate models. The third one is the combination of first two models. And yeah, in model three imports current account balance, M3 multiplier, M3 reserves output are statistically significant and correctly signed. Model four, M3 multiplier imports current account balance, oil are significant and are in line with the literature. In model five, banking credit, bank credit, real interest rate, M3 reserves, stock index, imports, current account balance, M3 multiplier, real exchange rate, output have the expected signs and are statistically significant. So to check the performance of all these models, we have taken the cutoff probability levels at 25%, 50% and 75%. In all these cutoff probability levels, model 5 outperforms all the other models, and logit model outperforms the KLR methodology. When it comes to KLR methodology alone, it performs well at 75%. Yeah. Irrespective of this exchange rate regime, like we could see that, like, you know, from 1986 to 2015, like it has been like there have been stress periods or crisis periods throughout these 30 years, and again, building early warning system may not guarantee the prevention of a crisis, but yeah, it can be a useful diagnostic tool. So I'll just summarize, like we focused on the recent history of our currency crisis or stress periods. We used two methodologies, Kaminsky legend to Reinhardt and logit models. And we found that logit model performs better than KLR methodology. And both these methodologies indicate that there is no relative importance to these three traditional models. And we also found that currency crisis in India is due to combination of different macroeconomic imbalances. Though Indian economy seems to be very stable for a decade, it's still not immune to currency crisis. Thank you.
Thank you, Mohan. Discussant Ajay Shah. You have 10 minutes, Ajay.
Thank you. I have some thoughts that will help think further about this subject. First, I think we should think more about what is a crisis. There are two very different things that happen. Sometimes you have an established exchange rate regime and you get a large shock that is inconsistent with the working of that regime. So for example, suppose you have a tightly managed rupee dollar exchange rate in a pegged exchange rate. There, the standard deviation of the exchange rate is like 0.1% per month. And you get a month where there was a 2% move. It's a giant move. It is something that is completely out of the distribution. It is a crisis. Okay. Case two, the very exchange rate regime changes. So I think these are important distinctions that we should make. And when you have a floating exchange rate, then a very large exchange rate change is actually normal, is par for the course. So I think that this paper is mixing up these three classes of events. That case one is under a tight rupee dollar peg, you have a large change. That's actually a crisis. Case two is a change in the exchange rate regime. That's a big event that is something that we should take notice of and changes our view of what was that crisis. It was big enough that we were not able to maintain the erstwhile exchange rate regime. And the third is under a float, you get a large exchange rate change. That's not a problem. It's a float. It's supposed to have large movements. It's like once you decontrol the price of steel, a month with a large movement in the price of steel is not a problem. It is not a crisis. Okay. Now, when we study India, you're doing a long time period from 1985 onwards. We need to be cognizant that there are major changes in the exchange rate regime. I've given you a ref. I have a co-authored paper in computational statistics and data analysis. And in the context of this paper, I think it's interesting to ask, why did an exchange rate regime change? Were there economic forces that led to the change in the exchange rate regime? And within a given exchange rate regime, what explains the outlier months? Here's an interesting graph. Each point on the graph is the volatility of the bilateral rupee dollar rate over a two-year window. So it's a centered two-year window. And what jumps out in this is two big dates of exchange rate regime changes, on the 23rd of May 2003 and on the 23rd of March 2007. Our methodology picks out roughly a doubling of exchange rate volatility. These are the big events of India's history, and we should think more about these. Then after 23rd March 2007, for some time we ran a float with vols like 8, 9, 10%. So when you have an 8, 9, 10% annualized vol, you know, fairly large currency movements every month are not a big deal. And then when Raghuram Rajan became governor, we've gone back to the 2007 arrangement. Okay, so that's the big story, that is the frame around which we should be thinking. And it's significantly different from the way in the paper you're thinking of the entire time series as homogeneous. My second comment is on exchange market pressure. There are problems of measurement with traditional EMP methods. For example, you have a sigma R sitting in a denominator in your formula. What that means is that when India floats the exchange rate, and in Subbarao's period, the volatility of reserves basically went to zero because Dr. Subbarao was not trading the currency market, you will get falsely large EMP values. And there has been methodological progress. Our previous discussant, Josh Fellman, has worked with Ila Patnaik and I on a paper which is building new methods for how to measure EMP. Here's an example of a graph. The upper pane is the more standard Aiken Green et al. Methodology. The bottom pane is our improved methodology. We know a lot more today about how to measure EMP, and I suggest that you use it. Finally, I have some thoughts on how to think better about currency crises. In any country at any point in time, there is a gap between investment and savings. I minus S is the import of capital. Okay, so this is the macroeconomic accounting identity. In every country at every time, the gap between investment and savings is financed from outside. And a crisis arises when there is a sudden change in the risk perception of the country, and the steady daily supply of foreign capital chokes. What is happening is that risk capital needs to renegotiate its fair price. And that takes time. There is a turbulence around that period. That's what happens in a currency crisis. And because that supply of risk capital has choked, you get an exchange rate adjustment. Now, the key thing to notice is how much does the exchange rate need to depreciate to produce equilibrium? And this is about short-term debt flows. As the exchange rate depreciates, it has to depreciate enough to excite short-term debt flows. Okay? Conversely, in the short term, the only thing that equilibrates a shortfall of the more risk capital is short-term debt. Okay? So we should be thinking about what factors matter. It's useful to think about two pieces. One is, what is it about a country where you can get sudden changes in risk perception? Okay? So what drives that asymmetric information? What drives gaps between perception and reality? And for example, I would put up weaknesses in national accounts as a serious problem. In a country where national accounts are not well measured, you can create large gaps between perception and reality. And then there will be like this Minsky moment where foreign investors will suddenly wake up and say, oops, actually this country is not what we thought it was. Trust in local institutions and predictability is a big factor. Every country gets into a difficult spot from time to time. Good institutions are the key. Then those institutions will work in a predictable way. Whereas in a country where there is less trust in local institutions, you will get jittery government responses, and that will make the crisis worse. And finally, when there is a backdrop of exchange rate management, there will be currency mismatch. And currency mismatch is what lays the foundation for extreme behavior by government and extreme behavior by foreign investors. And this could be either corporate or government. And this should be the intellectual frame around which we think, when can a country get into a currency crisis? And once a currency crisis begins, how does a country respond? Question one, how much is openness to short-term debt? A country that has more openness to short-term debt will get the I minus S filled without requiring a large change in the interest rate. The second is deep and liquid markets. Markets are the shock absorbers. When the currency market is more liquid, when currency hedges are more available, you will get a smaller crisis. And finally, the maturity of a government's response, that to the extent that good institutions are in play, we will get less jittery government responses. And blow by blow, literally every day, every week, when you watch a government doing more extreme things, that's going to give you a worse crisis. I have a suggestion. The 2013 crisis is the best studied crisis in India's history. It happened more recently. We had better financial markets data. There was a great deal of high quality research and commentary about the 2013 crisis. If you hunt on my blog, you'll find articles and you'll find all the links. So use it to develop intuition into what's going on, and I think you can make this paper stronger. Thank you.
Thanks, Ajay. Mohan, would you want to respond? Okay, so we have time to take questions from the floor, if there's any question.
I agree with what Ajay discussed. I think it's more about, since 91, India never had a currency crisis except 2013, as I mean, there was large volatility. I think the question should be, what is driving this currency volatility, or which factors are crucial in creating this big volatility in exchange rate? So if I look at your logit estimation, I mean, most of these variables are kind of giving counterintuitive results. You know, if you look at deposits, why would it increase probability of a currency crisis? Or you look at all the exports, why would it have a positive coefficient? It would have you would expect at least a negative coefficient, and increase in exports would lower probability of currency crisis, not increase. So, you know, I also, the other variables are similar, but I like, you know, you have GDP growth and you know, money multiplier, that is giving the right signal. So I don't know whether you are able to capture the you know, the what are the key indicators that could reflect this impending signs of currency crisis. So maybe you could pose the question differently, thinking about what are the key economic variables that are driving high exchange rate volatility in the market here. Thank you.
So I probably didn't say it carefully. Did you pick up the taper tantrum at all in your? There was. Yeah. So I guess what I'm getting at more realistically is we have some work to show, and you'll see that tomorrow too. That some of it is also sort of related to how banks get impacted in this whole thing. So as you know, I was sort of focusing on the taper tantrum as an example, which is also ignited by the currency crisis, but how also banks got the network relationships got worsened, and bank exposures sort of reached new heights, and there was a incremental probability of default that also hit the banking and financial system. So what I'm getting at is, you have some generic models there, but did you maybe I missed it completely, but did you have any discussion about taper tantrum as an example of how this filtered through? Because that taper tantrum was a very unique event in India, which had much more impact on India vis-a-vis rest of the emerging markets. I'll say more about that tomorrow, but I thought I'll just point that out. Because even if you use regime switching, et cetera, it may not work. It's sort of jump event there, so.
No, I have a rather simple question. See, since there were not many currency. Since there were not many currency crises during this period except one or two, what I'm afraid is that, you know, your dependent variable will get mostly value zero, and very seldom it will get values one. So I don't know how that works in terms of statistics and probability.
Sir, I have taken a 12-month crisis horizon. 12-month crisis horizon, like 12-month crisis window. So in that...
Can you please use the mic?
Yeah.
Thank you.
So I've taken 12-month crisis window. I assign one in that 12-month crisis window to the dependent variable. So in that way, it balances.
Yeah, so I have a couple of questions for you. One is, so since I used to trade the Indian rupee a long time ago, and one of the times that was very important was when we tested the nuclear bomb, and the rupee just went through the roof. So when you have stuff like that, when it's very extraneous, and you know, there is not much that fiscal deficit or anything has to do with it, it's all politics. And you know, as a segue to that, confidence in the economy, whether it was 2007 December when the rupee went below 40 for a brief moment, and then March 2008 when it was wherever 56. So when you have such a large movement, some of it is obviously the Indian economy was still doing well, but it was a global financial crisis and it was just de-risking going on. Is there a way to think about that? So in our practice, what we do is when the volatility goes down, we buy options to hedge. When the wall is very high, then we say it's not worth it, and we don't do anything. So I don't know whether it's the right way to go about it or not, but I'm just trying to figure out whether there's a smarter way to do this or not.
Do you have a response? Or?
I have a question.
We actually don't have any more time for questions.
Okay.
Or we can just take a question and then maybe he can respond later on. We can do that.
So just taking up from what Ajay mentioned is, so India has a controlled currency regime, right? So either the rate or the volatility. So if you see Ajay's graph on volatility, then you see there are structural breaks in volatility and there are clean regimes that can be viewed. And often they are linked to who the governor is, and you know, they at least they are clear and you can observe them. In the recent years, there is an independent market for the rupee offshore, right, which is the NDF market. And I think that from a particular point in time, which is around 2010 onwards, you start getting credible prices on the dollar rupee rate offshore, and which is not a controlled market, right, where all the actions that the central bank can take on volatility or managing the rate, you know, so while the market is linked to the domestic market, in a sense it is not a controlled market. And hence what might be interesting to see is in the periods where you do observe a crisis-like situation as you describe in your paper, what kind of behavior do you see in the offshore market? So do you really observe the same thing going on there and you get similar patterns in that market? So that should be something that's interesting to look at.
Thanks, Anjali. We don't have time for any more questions, so I'll request if there are any responses or discussion to take it offline. So that brings us to the close of the first session. Let's give a round of applause to the presenters and the discussants.